Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to Shankara Academy of Visions Learn from the Master Series. Today we have Bhavya, our faculty from Bangalore Shankara College of Optometry. Bhavya will be speaking on age-related macular degeneration and how to manage the reading and distance vision problems with ARMD. Bhavya is a bachelor and master's from Shankara College of Optometry. She has done her master's from Chitkara University and Shankara. And she is a specialist in low vision. She teaches low vision as well as practices low vision in Shankara Eye Hospital, Bangalore. Over to you, Bhavya.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. Today's session is on ARMD management. Let reading be not a barrier in geriatric population. So we'll be looking into low vision aspect as such today. ARMD, age-related macular degeneration, it is a degenerative disorder which affects the macula and it accounts for about 8.7% of the total blindness globally. This is the third common cause of visual impairment, and the prevalence of ARMD in a study done by Kulkarni SR in 2013 shows that 1.38% of prevalence, that is early prevalence, early ARMD being 1.14% and late ARMD being 0.24%. And this is the leading cause for irreversible blindness in the elderly population. So ARMD classification, it has been majorly divided into two types. That is the dry AMD or non-exudative or non-neovascular AMD. And usually in dry AMD, the symptoms would be gradual loss of vision and also fluctuation in the visual acuity. And the patient may tell that he may be seeing better in the bright light condition. And geographic atrophy is the advanced stage of dry AMD. Moving on, wet AMD, or it is also called as exudative or neovascular AMD. So this is much less common than the dry AMD, but it is associated with a rapid progression of advanced vision loss. And the main manifestations are choroidal neovascularization and pigment epithelium detachment. Usually the symptoms that the patient present in wet AMD would be a central scotoma, metamorphopsia. We have risk factors in AMD, that is hereditary being one of the risk factor. So family history is important. If a first relative degree is affected in AMD, then there would be a high chances of being ARMD running in the family. And also smoking is one of the risk factor. Hypertension and other cardiovascular risk factors are likely to be associated. And also dietary factors like high fat intake and obesity may also promote ARMD. Clinical features, we have drusens from ranging from small, intermediate to large size, and also degeneration of retinal pigment epithelium. And we also see altered macular pigmentation and neovascularization of choroidal membranes and also subretinal fluid accumulation. So these are the clinical features that we see in ARMD. Management would be prophylaxis treatment, that would be antioxidant supplements if it is indicative. Usually antioxidant supplements are indicative in dry AMD or early AMD, and treatment would be with anti-VEGF agents and also photodynamic therapy in case of neovascular AMD, and provision of low vision aids and rehabilitation. This is to further improve the patient's functional vision, and risk factors also should be addressed, that is smoking cessation and ocular sun protection, cardiovascular risk, and diet. Moving on, we have case presentation. So we had a patient of 75 year old. He was male, and the chief complaint of the patient was difficulty recognizing faces at a distance beyond 2 meters. And he had difficulty watching TV and also difficulty reading since 2 years of age. Ocular history, patient had his cataract surgery done in both eyes 2 years ago, and also multiple anti-VEGFs were given in both the eyes. Systemic illness, patient had history of hypertension since 10 years and he was on medication for the same. There was no history of allergies or patient was not aware of, and social history. Patient lives with his wife and son. Present glass prescription. Patient had stopped using glasses 2 months ago. He says that there was no difference with the glasses and without the glasses in the visual acuity. Ocular examination was done. Unaided visual acuity was right eye 1.3 logmar. There was also face turn noticed, and left eye, it was 1.1 logmar, and objective refraction showed right eye plano with minus 1.5 diopter cylinder in the at 70 axis, and left eye showed plano with minus 1 diopter cylinder at 90 axis. Subjective refraction, it showed right eye plano minus 1.25 diopter cylinder 70 axis, and the vision was 1.1 logmar, and left eye plano with minus 1 diopter cylinder 90 axis, and the vision was 1.0 logmar, and near vision was also checked, and near addition with 2.75 diopters of spherical in both the eyes, and the vision improved up to N18, and the patient could read at 20 centimeters. And near vision was taken with the Bailey-Lowy word reading chart under room illumination, and intraocular pressures were mentioned with the Goldman applanation tonometer. That was right eye 14 mm of Hg and left eye 15 mm of Hg at 11 a.m. Moving on to anterior segment evaluation, the anterior segment structures seem normal except for iris in the right eye. There was iris atrophy, which was present in present at 8 to 10 o'clock position, and lens was pseudophakic in both the eyes. Fundus examination. Right eye and left eye cup disc ratio was normal, and in right eye the foveal reflex was absent, and left eye tessellated fundus was seen, and also there was no foveal reflex. In right eye macula there was a large deciform scar, and left eye macula there was active CNVM, and peripheral retina looked normal, and the vessels in the periphery were also normal, and the patient was diagnosed as both eye exudative ARMD. So management for this case was first in the for the left eye, anti-VEGF Avastin was suggested. Post this, the patient was given Amsler grid chart for home use so that he can self-assess. He was also guided on to how to self-assess with the Amsler grid chart if there was any scotoma he had noticed. And the patient was asked to return to the hospital if he had noticed any scotoma or metamorphopsia. And also the patient was referred to low vision and rehabilitation clinic, and even the risk factors like smoking, ocular sun protection, and cardiovascular risk and dietary was also addressed for the patient. So as the patient was referred to the low vision and rehabilitation clinic, we had done a comprehensive low vision assessment to this patient. So personal history was recorded. The patient's education was a bachelor in veterinary science, and the patient's occupation, he was a retired veterinary doctor. Patient was married and he was not the breadwinner of the family. He was a partially dependent and he was dependent on his son. And the literacy status of the family, the son had done his MBA, and financial support was provided by son. Economic status of the family was good. Moving on, family history. There was no family history of visual problems, and additional disabilities were none. Patient did not have any other hearing disability or physical disabilities that was associated. Previous history of usage of spectacles, contact lens, or low vision devices. Patient did not use any contact lens or low vision devices earlier, but he had stopped using his spectacles 2 months ago, like I mentioned earlier. And also distance vision tasks, patient had difficulty recognizing faces, which was his major complaint. And also watching TV, reading bus numbers and sightseeing was difficult. intermediate tasks, patient was not using any computers currently. And also near vision tasks, reading was his priority. Difficulty, the patient had difficulty in reading newspaper and magazines, but he could manage reading at a closer distance. Writing was not a priority. Sometimes the patient used to sign checks or any documents. Moving on, we had also checked for light sensitivity, and the patient's preference of illumination was for natural light, and also the illumination quality was bright light. The patient did not have any problem in the glares, with glares in outdoor, and mobility issues. The patient had difficulty descending the stairs, and activities of daily living, he did not have any difficulty as such. So the patient was able to groom himself up, and there was no difficulty with identifying currency and all that. So he did not have any difficulty with respect to activities of daily living. Ocular examination further was checked for gross visual behavior. That was visual fixation was checked. The patient was having eccentric viewing, and his preference was left eye. Since the visual acuity was better in the left eye compared to the right eye, his ocular preference was for the left eye. And visual field also was done with the arc perimeter. And also the visual field showed that there was good amount of peripheral vision. Moving on, we have ocular examination. That was again color vision. Was checked with the Ishihara chart, and right eye, the patient was not able to appreciate the demo plate. This was due to the vision loss in the right eye that is there. And also left eye, the patient was able to identify demo plate only. And contrast sensitivity was done with Pelli-Robson chart, and right eye, the patient's contrast was 0.45 log CS, and left eye it was 0.60 log CS. And AMSLR was also done. Right eye, the test was deferred because the patient already had a large scotoma in the right eye, and the patient was not able to appreciate the central target on the AMSLR chart. And left eye, the patient had reported that he sees distorted line that was seen in the mid periphery towards his temporal side. Here, if you can see this picture of the AMSLR recording, he could see distorted line in the mid-periphery. So moving on to the distance magnification calculation and trial. So we had completed the functional vision evaluation, and also the patient's visual acuity and refraction was already done earlier. And moving on, we had checked for what devices can be given for distance and near, and also the trial was done accordingly. So the magnification that was required, here we considered target visual acuity divided by best corrected visual acuity. So the best corrected visual acuity, we always consider that the patient's best corrected visual acuity in his better eye. So the left eye had better visual acuity compared to the right eye. So we have chosen 6 by 60. So the 1.0 logMAR was converted to Snellen equivalent, and the target visual acuity here, the patient's major concern was recognizing faces from a distance and also watching TV. So the target visual acuity that was chosen was 6 by 12 for the task that the patient required. And magnification was 6 by 12 divided by 6 by 60. So we had got 5x magnification for distance. And next, we have done a trial for this patient with the 5x monocular handle telescope. And the ocular preference here was left eye. And the vision had improved up to 0.34 logMAR with the 5x monocular handle telescope. And the patient was also comfortable with better fixation, scanning, and also tracking of the letters. Moving on for near magnification calculation and trial. So before on to the calculation, we should always check the near visual acuity at a particular distance. Say, for example, in this case, the patient was reading N18 at 20 centimeters. So your target visual acuity should be 2 times smaller than the patient's requirement. So the patient had difficulty reading newspaper, and we had chosen the newspaper target size as N8. So this becomes the threshold, and the facility becomes N4. That is the 2 times we'll have to choose the smaller print size. And step three is to check for the magnification that is required. So here we use best corrected visual acuity by target visual acuity. That is, so the best corrected visual acuity was N18. So we have taken 18, and it was divided by 4. That is the target that we had chosen was N4. So we got the magnification as 4.5x. And step four was to find out the equivalent viewing distance. So equivalent viewing distance is the distance at which the patient could read clearly. That was measured by reading distance by magnification. So here the reading distance of the patient was 20 centimeters, and the magnification that we had got earlier was 4.5x. So 20 divided by 4.5 had given us 4.44 centimeters. And we'll have to convert this into meter to find out equivalent power. So equivalent power, it is 1 by EVD, that is 1 by equivalent viewing distance in meters. So that is equal to 1 by 0.044, so which is equal to 22.5 diopters. So this was the power that is required for near magnification for the patient. So the patient would require a spectacle magnifier of 22.5 diopters, and the distance here is 4.44 centimeters. So this has to be prescribed monocularly, because binocularity doesn't exist at a working distance of 4.44 centimeters, and practically it would not be possible for the patient to keep the reading material closer, that is at 4.44 centimeters. So we can prescribe monocularly and at a working distance, and also the working distance has to be explained for the patient if we are prescribing this monocular spectacle magnifier. And the next trial was done for handheld magnifier. So here the patient's best corrected visual acuity is both eyes N18 at 20 centimeters, and the target would be N8 to read newspaper and also magazines. So the magnification for EVD, so like we had calculated earlier, it would come up to 4.5x, that is the facility. And EVD is distance by magnification. So the distance here is 20 centimeters divided by 4.5x. So that is 4.44 centimeters. And EVP, we know it is, you can either take it as 100 by EVD. So if you take 100 by EVD, then your EVD should be in centimeters. If you're taking it, if you're converting the EVD into meters, then you can take it as 1 by EVD. So 100 by 4.44 will give you 22.52 diopters. And again, converting this diopters to X magnification, considering 1X is equal to 4 diopters, we get 5.6X as the magnification. So the magnification required for the handheld magnifier would be 5.6X, and the patient could read at 4.44 centimeters. And also, the trial was done with the close approximated magnification, that is 6x illuminated handheld magnifier, and the patient could read N8 but with difficulty, and the reading speed was 15 words per minute. So this was the trial that was done with the handheld magnifier in this patient. Moving on, we have a trial that is the option of telemicroscope or a reading cap. Here again, EVD will be the distance at which the patient reads by magnifications. So say, for example, if the patient would wish to read at 25 centimeters, then we substitute the same numbers here. That is, EVD would be 4.44 centimeters, and the distance at which the patient would wish to read would be 25 centimeters divided by magnification. So the magnification that we achieve here is 5.63x. And if the patient wishes to read at 25 centimeters, so in case of telemicroscope, we attach a reading cap of plus 4 diopters with 6x telescope. And this gives a working distance of 25 centimeters. So like you see in the picture, so that is a telescope and we can attach a reading cap of plus 4 diopters with this. The only disadvantage of prescribing a reading cap would be poor cosmosis, and also the patient may feel heavier as the telescope magnification increases. So the next trial that was done was for CCTV or a video magnifier. So the patient's EVD in this case was that which we found out was 4.44 centimeters, and the patient wants to use CCTV. So the required magnification would be, so here we have to consider the reference distance for CCTV. So that is reference distance here would be the distance between the eye and the CCTV, which the patient prefers to read. So if a patient prefers to read at 40 centimeters, then that would be your reference distance for calculating EVD. So we know EVD here for calculating magnification. So we know the EVD here, that is 4.44 centimeters, and the reference distance is 40 centimeters here. So the magnification required would be 9x magnification. So the total magnification, it will vary depending upon the patient's reference distance. Say for example, some patients may prefer 30 centimeters, that is the distance between the eye and the CCTV. Or sometimes the patient may even prefer 25 centimeters as their reference distance. So with the video magnifier or CCTV, the patient could read innate at 40 centimeters comfortably, and the reading speed also increased, that is up to 30 words per minute. So in this case, the patient also preferred to go with the CCTV. And one of the advantage of the CCTV is that you can change even the contrast in with respect to CCTV. That is, you can choose a black over black letters over white background, or white letters over black background. So these modifications can also be done with the help of CCTV, and it gives a better contrast. The only disadvantage here could be the cost factor. Other than that, the patient would be very comfortable reading at 40 centimeters. Even the age of the patient also has to be considered. So ergonomics wise also, CCTV would be more comfortable for the patient. Moving on, the non-optical devices that we suggested for this patient was check guide and signature guide. So this is a check guide here, which would help the patient in better contrast so that he can write easily when he's writing a check, and also signature guide when he has to sign any documents. So this was more helpful for the patient. So the final prescription that was given for the patient was for distance, the optical aids was spectacle prescription was given for distance, and also 5x monocular handle telescope was given for spot viewing. So this could help the patient in recognizing faces at a distance, or also reading bus numbers at a distance. So 5x monocular handle telescope, it was given for spot viewing. And the optical aids for near was again a spectacle was prescribed with near addition, along with the video magnifier, which the patient was comfortable after the trial. And non-optical devices suggested were the check guide and signature guide. So this was the final prescription that we had suggested for this patient. And moving on, the patient was also referred to rehabilitation clinic. Counseling was done for the patient regarding the concession that he could receive in travel, and also old age pension that he could receive. And also the training was given to use the optical low vision devices. So after the trial, it is always important to give training on how to use optical low vision devices. So with training sessions, the vision improvement also can be seen. And also the patient would feel more confident to use the device in his daily life. So this would make the patient independent as well. And also the environmental modification was suggested for the patient by putting extra lights in the staircase or stairway, and also by suggesting to use these high contrast strips or fluorescent strips on the stairs so that the patient would feel easier while descending the stairs, as this was one of the patient's major complaints with respect to mobility as such. So this was the rehabilitation aspect of the patient. So in case of ARMD, so the other management options would be if the patient is diagnosed earlier, that is in case of dry AMD, simply giving high-yard reading glasses would also help. Even stand and handle magnifiers also could help the patient. And also even the small difference in the visual acuity can make a positive difference in his visual performance, and also that improves the quality of life of the patient. And again, CTV binocular telescopes, they are also mostly suitable for recognizing faces and watching television. And again, like we mentioned earlier, the CCTV systems, they help patients with reading, and the reading speed also will be faster. But the only disadvantage, like I mentioned earlier, this could be expensive. So in case of eccentric viewing training, so for the rehabilitation, it is important to know what retinal location is optimal for eccentric fixation. So eccentric fixation is patients, they have sensation of looking directly at the fixation target. Whereas eccentric viewing, so the patient looks away in order to see the target. So the patient uses his non-foveal point to look at the target. PRL refers to preferred retinal locus. So it is a pseudo-foveal area. This is adopted by the patient in order to see the chosen targets or objects. Whereas trained retinal locus is the eccentric retinal area, which the clinician determines that it is the best position to train eccentric viewing. And with the help of eccentric viewing training, the confidence in tasks of daily living, and also it improves reading as well, and also it helps in mobility. So according to a study done on rehabilitation of reading in older individuals with macular degeneration, they also say that improving peripheral reading can be done with eccentric viewing training along with controlling eye movements by giving oculomotor training. So basically this oculomotor training is done with the help of auditory responses. So this will facilitate the optimal placement of the text on the preferred retinal locus, and it will improve the eccentric viewing. And also perceptual learning also training can be given. So this involves discrimination or detection of perceptual stimuli by repeated exposure to these stimulus. So again, along with the eccentric viewing training, even the oculomotor training and perceptual learning can help in better reading speed of the patient. But the extensively practiced method for patients with the central visual field defect would be eccentric viewing training. And this result, according to the study, it resulted into average reading speeds. So up to 60 to 80 words per minute. This was the training result. So if you can see the letter here, so the eccentric viewing training starts with the training with single letters, and then they move on to training with three-letter words, and then they move on to training with sentences. That is how the eccentric viewing training takes place. And also the training requires a lot of time. So with the time and training, the patient would definitely improve his reading speed. So these are my references and my acknowledgments to Low Vision and Rehabilitation Clinic, Shankar Eye Hospital, Bangalore, and my faculty and colleagues. Shankara College of Optometry, Bangalore and Ludhiana. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Bhavya. That was an interesting presentation on ARMD and how to handle it. So there are a few questions that we have for you. Mrs. Devakani Suresh from Dubai says that she had a similar case yesterday, except that the gentleman was 55 years old and recovering from a recent stroke. In your opinion, do you suggest any additional devices that you can talk about?
In case of stroke, sir?
I suppose he had ARMD and he was recovering from stroke. That's what I understand from the question.
Okay. So, first we'll have to do a evaluation, that is the complete evaluation in this case. And also, if it is a case of stroke, then like ma'am said, if the patient is already recovering, then definitely we can go with the training. So also the psychosocial impact of the stroke also has to be kept in concern with respect to this patient.
Would you suggest any other devices apart from the ones that you used for your patient?
Again, it depends upon the severity of the disease, sir. So we'll have to check for the near vision. We can also prescribe stand magnifiers in this case. Mm-hmm. And also handle magnifiers if the patient is comfortable with the working distance. So we can also prescribe handle magnifiers of greater magnification also.
Probably since the patient has stroke, so I don't know what all was affected.
Yes, sir.
Possibly we would like to avoid things which require manipulation, physical manipulation in terms of using the hand. So we might like to avoid things which are handheld or so probably we may look at a spectacle telescope. We may look at like what you mentioned, the stand magnifier or things like that, which do not require manipulation physically. I think Devakani, probably that answers your question. If you can type it out, we'll be able to answer more. Okay, there's another question from Ms. Nikita.
She
wants you to elaborate on how magnification helps in cases of central scotoma.
So with respect to magnification, what happens is the letter size increases, that is, with the help of low vision devices, we see the increase in the letter size. The relative scotoma appears to be smaller or negligible with help of magnification.
Okay. Mrs. Vandana Kamath wants to know if you can explain about arc perimetry.
Ma'am, arc perimeter, it is actually done at a closer distance. So we keep the arc perimeter at patients. So we keep the central target at the patient's nasal point, and we check the visual field. That is, we do this monocularly. So first we check for the quadrants, that is inferior, superior, nasal and temporal quadrants, and we go for oblique quadrants, and the same way we perform for the left eye also. So if there is a patient who is not able to identify the central target while doing the arc perimeter, we can gradually increase the size of the target, or in case of pediatric population, we can choose colored targets which would grab their attention.
Thanks, Pavya. Mrs. Devakani Suresh again has a query. She wants to know the target acuity what you had kept for your patient was N4 and not N8. Why was it so?
Ma'am, N8 would be the threshold. So we would always recommend to keep two times better the threshold, the visual acuity. So we chose N4 as our facility.
Okay, so Devakani, probably what you are doing is you are calculating on the base of threshold and multiplying it by 2. So this as well as that will work out the same. So instead of N8, she has kept it as N4. So she is not converting threshold into facility, but then she is keeping facility straight away by keeping the target N4. Is that fine, Bhavya?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Coming back to her previous question, she has just mentioned that it was a very informative session. And how many visits do you plan for the patient when you prescribe more than 2 devices, and when will the scheduled follow-up be?
After training, we would always recommend the patient to get back to us, so the patient can also get back to us on the phone call. And even we would try to follow up with the patient. So initially, after 2 weeks, we would call up the patient and ask if they are comfortable with the device. And after 2 weeks, if the patient is comfortable, then we would ask the patient to follow up with us after 3 months and after 6 months initially.
Thanks, Bhavya. Vinay Kumar wants to know if people with ARMD retain their peripheral vision.
Yes, sir. Definitely in people with AMD, the central vision would be affected. So their peripheral vision should be retained.
Unless there are more retinal changes in the periphery also.
Yes, yes. Yes, sir.
Or they don't undergo any kind of detachments or vitreous
changes. Yeah, or if there is, if there are no other pathology which is associated with AMD, then definitely their peripheral vision should be retained.
He again wants to know the relationship between RPE and choriocapillaries in AMD.
Sorry, sir, I didn't understand.
He wants to know the relationship between retinal pigment epithelium
and
choriocapillaries in AMD.
Okay. So definitely, if there is any changes in the pigment epithelium, that also affects the functional vision of the patient. If the pathology is extended up to choriocapillaries, then there may be chances of vision loss, which is there, sir. So the vision loss may be prominent, maybe you can add up for this.
So probably the choriocapillaries, they break through and cause the hemorrhage. And that could possibly lead to vitreous hemorrhage and further complications.
Yes.
So choriocapillaries are actually responsible for the damage that are possibly caused in AMD if it is uncontrolled.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Bhavya, Mrs. Renu Thakur compliments you on an excellent presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
She wants to know what you will give for AMD patient regarding lighting during reading. Would you prescribe anything specific for lighting when he...
Yes, sir. Always based on the preference of the illumination that the patient prefers. So in this case, the patient had preferred for bright illumination. So in case if the patient do not have access to natural bright light, then we can always suggest for extra light, which the patient would be comfortable for reading.
Mm-hmm. So do you advise any specific types of lamps or auxiliary lighting or something?
Sir, incandescent lights may help the patient.
And you suggest that it comes from front or comes from behind the shoulder or straight down, anything like that?
Yes, sir. We'll have to look into that, sir. Before prescribing, we'll have to look into, we have such a facility in the low vision and rehab department. So based on the patient's preference, we can suggest which would be the patient, which will be comfortable for the patient.
Okay. Mr. Vinay Kumar wants to know if there's a possibility of reducing the chances of siblings and children getting AMD.
So like I said, AMD, it affects usually the geriatric population. Yes, definitely with genetic counseling, maybe chances of we could always refer them to genetic counseling.
Okay. Mr. Rauf Khan has asked, why did you use a reading cap of only 4 diopters plus 4 diopters?
So if you consider the focal length of plus 4 diopters, the focal length would be 25 centimeters. So the patient also would wish to read at 25 centimeters. So a reading cap of plus 4 diopters would facilitate the patient to read at 25 centimeters. I hope that answers the question.
Mr. Dhanaraju wants to know how we can prescribe prisms in cases of age-related macular degeneration.
So usually we don't prescribe prisms unless it is a spectacle magnifier. We do prescribe Bayesian prisms to relieve convergence. Other than that, prisms usually we prescribe for peripheral field loss.
Okay. Any idea how you prescribe for reading for in spectacles? I think that's what he wants to know.
Say, for example, if based on the calculation, if the equivalent power is up to plus 12 diopters, then we add two prism basin for the dioptric power, and we'll have to prescribe, say, for example, if it was plus 12, then we prescribe plus 14 basin prisms in both the eyes.
So you're prescribing plus 14, the 14 prisms basin in both the eyes, or? Each eye separately.
Each eye separately we have to prescribe.
So you're talking of about 28 prisms in both eyes.
Yes, sir. Is there a confusion here? I couldn't get that.
No, what I was asking you was, you're talking of 14 prisms based in each eye, right?
Yes, sir.
So on the whole, you're talking of 28 prisms.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Bhavya, I think these are the questions that we have right now. In case anyone has more questions, please do write to us, and Bhavya will be more than happy to answer those questions for you.
Yes, sir.
I think we come
Thank
to an
you,
oh, there's one more. There's just one more from Mr. Navneet Sharma from Chandigarh, and complimented you on a very knowledgeable lecture.
Thank you, sir.
So he's asked if we suggest any specific recommendation for using low vision devices or training for the improvement in reading speed in AMD.
Like I mentioned earlier, with the help of low vision devices, the training for eccentric viewing can be given, and this will improve the patient's reading speed, sir.
And how long do you give this training?
Sir, it is based on the patient's acceptance, or the patient's reading speed also would be measured with each training session.
Okay, yes, thank sir. You, Bhavya. Thanks a lot for a wonderful lecture.
Thank you, sir.
So thank you very much, audience, and we'll see you tomorrow. We take a day off, and we see you back on Monday, same time, same channel. 12 o'clock in the noon, and we will be with Ms. Bhavna, who is a faculty from Shankara College of Optometry, Bangalore, and she will be talking about managing patients with visual field loss. So see you on Monday, same time, same channel. Stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.